So here is the problem. So it's a very interesting problem. Let me, so the way I should do it is, let me just put it as functions only, okay? Yeah, let's put it as it was, okay? So let f1, f2, and f3. So these three are functions from, I don't know if others know about this problem, functions from R to R, okay? And these are monotonic, okay? Monotonic, or it won't matter, so I'm calling them increasing. Okay, so let's kind of just simplifying a few things, but it's not a loss of generality. Increasing functions, okay? And all linear combinations of f1, f2, and f3 are monotonic, okay? And c1, f1 plus, so non-increasing is also okay, yeah? Or rather a constant non-increasing or non-decreasing is also fine. You have this is monotonic. For all C1, C2, C3 in R. Okay. Though we want to show that F1, F2, and F3 are linearly dependent. Okay. So what we want to show is that there is some lambda 1 and some, you know, lambda 2 and lambda 3 like this. Such that this is equal to 0. So 0 here means it becomes a 0 function. Okay. There are a lot of things to learn from this question, a lot of small tricks maybe, or ideas, I should say. Yeah. So f1, f2, and f3 are increasing functions, and any c1, c2, c3 you take, yeah, that is also increasing, which is a very strange thing. It doesn't usually happen, you can imagine. And in fact, that's what we're trying to say, that it doesn't happen, because then the third function is just a combination of the other two. Right. So just think. So this problem will be really instructive because, yeah, maybe. So my first question is, I think this is a good question to ask maybe, is can you give examples of two functions such that all linear combinations are monotonic? Just two functions. So give me example of f1 and f2 such that all linear combinations are monotonic, which implies f1, f2 also monotonic. Can we at least do this? Yeah, this is, should be able to do. Any two? Huh. Yes, that's good. That's a perfect example, right? So yeah, in fact, you can even take, but yeah, this is good enough. Yeah, so linear functions, you see they exist. And so you can take, yeah, so I think this everybody understands, right? You can take ax plus b and you can again take something, some other linear function. Obviously, combination will again be linear, and so that's fine. So linear functions certainly work. Yeah. So for two functions, it's possible. It's kind of possible to make them. Is it because this is CX plus D? Then it is possible. Okay, that's fine. Yeah. Yeah, that's fine. If F2 is just a multiple of F1 and F1 is monotonic, then that's fine. Yeah. But otherwise, we have this. And even these two functions are quite related, right? I mean, you can find some linear combination to make constant. So that's certainly works. But my question is, so let me, this is a question, another thing that you can think is, can you make a given example where this is linear and this is, so it cannot be quadratic, can it be cubic? Can you give an example of this nature where one is linear and the other is cubic? I think the answer should be no, but let's think. All right. I mean, apart from some trivial examples, you can obviously give F1 equal to 1. It's not linear, but let's say you can say that always, all right? F1 equal to 1. But so you guys get the question? Can you give, because cubic, like X cube you can take, that's monotonic. You can take any linear, it's monotonic. But any F1 and F2, any such cubic and linear, you can give me such that all linear combinations are monotonic. It seems it should be no, right? Because at some point one will start having more power when you change the C. And just think, it may be possible. Constant becomes constant of what becomes zero? Ah, okay, okay. You're going like that. Yeah, okay. Achha. So that the constants become zero. Yeah, so then let's just assume that it doesn't have any, because it doesn't really matter. See, the constant terms don't matter. I hope everybody agrees with that. Yeah. The constant terms don't matter. Yeah, constant, adding a constant, multiplying a constant to a function doesn't affect increasing, decreasing monotonicity at all. So let's forget that there are constants. Let's just take X cube. I mean, if you take X cube and you take, Oh, right, but that cannot happen. That you're right. It cannot happen because for some C1, C2, you can make it negative. Yeah, so you're in the right direction, but you're going to send right. You have to make it monotonic for all. So that's a good method. Why not use derivatives? Yeah, that's very good. So, yeah, so this will, so if this is true, then I'm just writing what he has said. Good, good. So it means that you want, let's say you want this to be, So you do not want, I'm just being a little wrong. So what should we not want from this derivative? Yeah, so this this should be either positive for all x or negative for all x for all c1, c2. So you guys understand what I'm trying to say, right? So for any C1 and C2, this should either be increasing or be decreasing. If it's increasing, then the derivative should be positive, greater than or equal to zero for all X or less than or equal to zero for all X. But this is not possible, right? I mean, you can always make the discriminant positive by adjusting the C1 and C2. I hope you guys agree with that. Is that right? I mean, yeah, the quadratic, you can always adjust. and make the discriminant positive. The discriminant is positive, then this expression for some C1, C2 can be the discriminant positive, then this expression will take both positive and negative values. You know, so not possible. So it is not possible, right? If you have a linear and a cubic, then it is not possible. Oh, these are just, again, some numbers, some real numbers. I've not written it completely. Sorry. Once again, so someone else uses the laptop, they increase the brightness a lot. Okay, so I want you to show that there is some lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3 so that it can become 0. I'm not solving the question, but I'm giving you this, like, yes, exploring this, right? That if you take two functions, then even then to make that all linear combinations are positive, we need that both have to be linear. You cannot have one cubic. Even you cannot have both cubic. You guys are feeling that, right? But obviously these are special functions. This is about general functions. Vector, how can a vector take these three values, vector or a function? But vector cannot take values like this. Then it is not in R3. Then it is in space of all functions from R to R, cross functions from R to R, cross functions from R to R. Right, you understand. If you're considering, then? No, but this is an infinite dimension. No, I think there is a lot of holes, in that. Yeah, if you say like that, because these are not vectors in R3, right? These are some very strange things. No, because these are arbitrary functions, right? So these are not any differentiable or so. This is not a calculus question, okay? It is not at all a calculus question. Okay, because these are arbitrary functions. So let me show you a view which I thought of. Okay, and then I'll leave you guys to complete the question from there. Yeah, because maybe you cannot think of it. Because at least let's see. So what I'm trying to say is that if you look at a function, what is a function? So if you look at just an arbitrary function f from R to R, then how can you view this? So you can view this function as if it is a list. A list. I have found this very useful, this to view things like this. You can view a function as a list. So if it's a function, I should say that first. Let's say that if a function from 10, 1 to 10 to 1 to 10, then what is it? It is a list of 10 items, or rather, every function is a list of 10 numbers, and each of these inputs are coming from 1 to 10. So list of 10 things where the entries are coming from 10 to 10. So it's a list of numbers from 1 to 10, indexed by numbers from 1 to 10. If you have a real, so if you have a function from R to R, so that's what a function is, just a list. Then basically, it's also a list. But the list is indexed by real numbers. Indexed. See, to tell you the solution, I don't need to say all this, but I'm just saying so that you get some idea, so that you can use it. Indexed by reals. Okay, it's a list which is indexed by reals, and so it is indexed by the reals, and there is a list. The list is for the reals. It means the entries are also real. Okay, and filled with reals. Okay, so in that sense, well, I could have just actually changed this question for N to R. Maybe then it's a better thing. So let me just change that immediately. Yeah, then you can just look at it as a sequence. Yeah, that's problem is still true. So because indexed by reals, maybe you swallow that. It's a little difficult to swallow that in the beginning. But just indexed by naturals, and so it's just a sequence. It's a function. F is just a sequence, just a list. That's what a function is, right? So it is like a vector with in infinite dimensional space. It's like a vector with infinitely many components. Forget about infinite dimensional space. It is just a vector which is indexed by infinitely many things, right? And we want to say that, so this is a vector, or this is a sequence. F2 is a sequence, F3 is a sequence. Sequence, or you can say it's a vector with infinitely many parts. Okay, now we are saying that this is a combination of the vectors. That's what this will be, right? That, so if you, so if in F1, so if this is, let's say 2, right? And this pi in F2, and E in F3 in the first place. Okay, then what happens is when you take the combination, then what do you get in the first place, right? You get C1 or maybe just, yeah, 2C1 plus pi C2 plus EC3. This is what you get in the first place, and so on, so on. So this is what the sequence becomes. Then just the new sequence you get, take combination of sequences, or just the combination of functions or the linear combination of vectors. Okay, so this here, it's a problem about infinite vectors or about sequences. So this was the question I saw, and then what I asked Chandan to do, and this is what I'm going to ask all of you to do, and we'll do this now, and then you guys can complete the problem on your own later, is instead of looking at this infinite, you know, infinite list vectors with infinitely many parts, why not look at vectors with just 3 parts? You know, why? This will be, let's solve that problem. We'll see if you can do that. Okay. So you guys understand, right? This problem is not like I'm making the problem hard, because there is nothing more given about this. These are in fact infinite. These are in fact sequences. There's nothing, they are nothing special. It's not like I'm just making it too general. No, it is like that. Okay. So I can replace this N to R, which is basically R to the power N, R in N times, to just R cube. So just changing the question. Okay, so I mean, I could write this as, you could, if you want to see it in that notation, it's 3 to R. No, 1, 2, 3 to R. Okay, 3 places. And then maybe you can still call it functions, but let's just call them vectors now. Okay. Or let's not do that. Yeah, let's continue to call them functions. And let's continue to keep the same notation, because otherwise later on you'll have problems in translating. Okay. So these are just in R3. Now you guys think, what does monotonic mean? What does monotonic mean now? So initially it was monotonic sequences, right? Monotonic sequences, monotonic function, monotonic sequences. That's what it was. Now it's just the vector in R3, but the coordinates are increasing. Okay, so F1 is just the vector in R3. So you can just call it like this, in fact. And F1 at 3. So can anybody tell me what does monotonic mean for this? How would it translate here? No. So just line. No, maybe what I'm asking is, F1 is a vector in R3, just a web point in R3. What is it? What does monotonic mean here? Well, monotonic condition just means that this is the situation, right? Increasing, or let's say F1 is increasing. So it just means that this is the case. Does everybody agree with this? This is what was given initially, right? If it was for infinite terms, then the terms were increasing. If it becomes a function from R to R, then it's an increasing function. As you increase the inputs, increase the outputs. Here also, as you're increasing inputs, 1, 2, 3, it's out. Is it fine? Okay. So that's what it's given, right? So similarly, you have one vector, and similarly, you have three vectors. Okay. Yeah, let's take three vectors. So there's a problem. Never mind. I've written it. So now similarly you have three vectors. So now you are given that these three vectors are in increasing, each of the coordinates are increasing on an order, and any linear combination is also increasing in order. So what does that mean? So you see the coordinates are increasing in order, and after taking any linear combination also it's increasing in order. So what does that mean? Is it understandable? Are you understanding what I'm doing? It's like there's 1, 2, 3 for F1, and then, well, I should not even put a comma, but fine. Like pi, pi square, pi cube. Understand? And then this could also be something like that, e plus 1, e plus 3. Okay, so now I'm saying that any combination is also increasing. So is it possible that you take any linear combination and what you get will still be, so final vector you get, the coordinates will still be in increasing order. You see, that's what the question is telling you. That's what the hypothesis is telling us. You guys see, Chandan, Rasur, is it understandable? Okay. Which part? Yeah, so see, basically, initially F1, F2, F3, okay, let's forget about initially. Here, so F1, F2, F3 are, let's say, three vectors in R3, okay? There are three vectors in R3. One second, so mute. Yeah, okay. Okay, no, so what I'm saying is, that F1, F2, and F3 are three vectors in R3, okay? Such that the coordinates are in increasing order, right? That's what increasing function means, right? Initially, if it's an increasing function from R to R, if F1 was an increasing function from R to R, then what did it mean? That as you increase the inputs, the outputs increase. Now, if you consider F1 as a function from N to R, then it's an increasing sequence. Yeah, as you increase the inputs, as you go down in the sequence, the terms increase. If you further reduce the problem, then it becomes a vector in R3. It's a sequence with only three terms. Then what should it mean? It should mean that terms increase as you go down the coordinates. Right? And well, that's what it means to say monotonic. Okay, so then we are given that there are three vectors in R3 such that their coordinates are in increasing order, like an example I've given. Plus it is given, which is rather strange, and it's impossible, mostly that's what we are trying to prove, is that any linear combination of these three vectors you take, it will still be increasing. You said, right? Any linear combination of these vectors you take, you get another vector and the coordinates will still be in increasing order as you move from left to right. Second coordinate will be bigger than third coordinate or equal to, and so on. Is the question more clear to everyone? Yeah, Rasavro and Raghav, is it clear? Because I've translated the question and usually we don't see it like this, but yeah. Any combination is increasing. But what do you know about vectors? if you have three vectors in R3, or let's make it even more easier. Let's take three vectors in R2. I don't need to decrease it. I could still give it a reason, but let's now make it even more simple, right? Let's just take them in R2. Now something should clearly strike you. If three vectors in R2, then is it possible that every linear combination is monotonic? If it is possible, then three vectors in R2 Well, the moment you hear three vectors in R2, the first thing that should come up is that they're linearly dependent, right? Fitting three vectors in R2, these three have to be linearly dependent. You can take two of them. There will be two of them whose combination would be the third one. You guys know this. Yeah, we have seen this in linear algebra or whatever. You can see it here also. When we did a little bit of vectors earlier, matrices and so on, we saw this, right? So there is a combination. So there is a combination which makes it zero. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. This is zero. Zero means, no, both the coordinates are zero. Is it okay? And that's what we wanted to show for R2. That's a different, but I'm saying for R2, is it clear that it becomes zero? So yet you don't need, because in R2 you don't really need, right? But to now conclude the same thing for R3, you need a monotonic. Because in R3 it is not true. As Raghav has said, if you take three vectors in, so if an R for R2 you don't need monotonic, because what does it mean to say monotonic in two networks even? But now if you had three vectors, then you would, no, so I'm sorry. So maybe I should say strictly. That is needed. Otherwise, you can just take constants, right? Or give me 1 second. Zero. And if it is not given to be strictly, then the third one can be, yeah. So I think you should put strictly. Yeah, so I hope that is not very much problematic. Okay. So now you think why you would need, how would you conclude the same thing for R3? Yeah, we want to be able to say this for R3 also, but that doesn't follow from matrices and vectors theory only. Well, if these two are zero, right, then is it possible that the what can this be? Some constant. Okay. No, but here it's slightly different. These are the values. These are not adding in the function. These are the value of the function at 3. So So what is wrong? It may be greater than zero, right? But we are not able to use the monotonicity. That is a problem. So how do you use the monotonicity? Well, you want to use the monotonicity, then you have to do like this. You take a combination. If you be a little smart here, I mean, in the sense that you have to take a combination so that the first and the third coordinates become zero. That you can do. This, let's say, C. So I'm taking a combination so that the first and the third coordinates become zero. But I want to, so the goal is now to say that the second coordinate is also zero. Reason why the second coordinate should also be zero. Yes, yes. Yeah, in fact, so I was wrong. You don't need strictly. So someone please explain like a little detail why. No. You don't need. You can explain in this. No, but that is strictly monotonic, so that's not a problem. I mean, that example is already not strictly. No, but in this case, so just try to give an explanation, you will see that you don't need strictly. So someone explain this in full, why the C should be zero. Yes, yeah. And no, yeah, point is that this should be monotonic. Yeah, this should be monotonic. Right, that is given to us, right? That this linear combination should be monotonic, right? I mean, after you take the linear combination, the final answer should be monotonic. Okay, what does it mean? So that implies that we should have that zero is less than equal to C or less than equal to zero, or zero is greater than equal to C, greater than equal to zero. Right? Because the final answer should be monotonic. That's the reasoning I'm using. Okay, so I'm not using like that, that the coordinates, I understand from there also you can, one of the terms meaning one of the coordinates. Okay. No. But then you might need different combinations. You understand? You can make any two coordinates zero by some linear combination, but here we are having one lambda one, another lambda two, another lambda three. These three itself is making all the coordinates zero. There is a big difference. You guys agree? Otherwise, you can do anything. Okay, you need one lambda one, lambda two, lambda three, which makes all the coordinates simultaneously zero. It makes the vector zero. It makes the function zero. Okay, so this reasoning I am using, the final function has to be monotonic. That gives a straightforward reasoning. You can base it. I think that's what Rasubha you were saying. Maybe that on the there itself on the vectors being increasing themselves, but it also follows from here. So yeah, so Chandan, do you see then that this is the approach for R3? We are able to do like this. I mean, if we replace the functions from R to R by functions from 3 to R, but I believe you guys can do the same thing for functions from 4 to R. Right? हाँ टू जीरोस बिकॉज यू सी यू टेक दिस थिंग एंड यू टेक दिस थिंग एंड जस्ट लुक एट दिस टू फॉरगेट द मिडल वन दैट इज नाउ दिस इज थ्री वेक्टर्स इन आर टू दैट इज द थिंग इनिशियली नॉट इंडक्शन नो आई वोंट अग्री विद इंडक्शन इफ से इंडक्शन देन हाउ आर यू यूजिंग मोनोटोनिसिटी Okay. Okay. I won't agree unless you say something more. Like in what way? Yeah, maybe yeah, if you unless you say I don't see induction, yeah, and it's a little different, like you know, two extreme points and yeah. Similarly for four, you can take four coordinates, but one shouldn't be afraid. Right, because you can make the first and the you can just forget the middle ones, right? Again, you can just look at the first and the last, and you have one linear combination which makes the first and the last zero. But then the same linear combination, so that's why I'm saying is non-inductive in that sense. Same linear combination makes the middle one also zero because the final answer has to be monotonic. Yeah, that's like poetic way to say maybe, but I don't know. It's logical. Oh, okay. Then you will need more vectors. Okay, yes. That's correct. Yeah. Okay, that's a different thing you are saying. Then, if there are three vectors, so if there are vectors in three dimensions, then you need four vectors to ensure that they will they can be made zero simultaneously. And if you have four vectors, then you need five dimensions. Okay. Right. That's right. But we are not going to higher dimensions because those are actually non-trivial facts. Okay, in the sense, okay, whatever, but don't think that I'm using higher dimensions. I mean, that's the wrong concept you would have if you think like that. I'm only using the thing that there are three vectors in two dimensions. I'm not using four dimension anything. Do you guys see my point? I'm not using anything like that. Okay, I'm just saying that, so if there are four, then I will just write like this, see. Just, I've already shown you, consider the values of the function at one and the values of the function at four. That's all. Don't think I'm just doing some fancy stuff today. No, it is the same simple stuff. Okay. Looking at the initial and final values, I can make a linear combination of these zero. Okay. But if that happens, then the middle term should also become zero. If the increasing function, like a linear combination, that's an increasing function whose value at one and four is zero. So the middle value should also be zero. Done. Not saying anything fancy. Okay. Then you guys can think how to do this for functions from R to R. It is simple and do it. Okay. And you can write and show it to me. There is something you have to think in the argument a little bit. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So then let's, there are no questions and we'll clean it. I just drink some water and come.
मैं इसमें वीडियो क्यों ऑन करते रहते हो
Okay, so I'm back. So are there any questions? I just gave you guys some time so you can think about it. Okay. Move on. Okay, let's move on. So I just want to do a few simple trick problems, okay, in differential equations. Okay, I want especially those who are giving the entrances here in MCQs, you have to be good. So I found a few cool so I was some for some reason doing something and I was thinking this topic is a little, so I had this question. So this is from a book called G.F. Simmons, but you probably won't have the time to study this, so leave it. But there are a few parts which are very nice. So just want to see if you can do it. So one second. So there are these questions in which, why is that say not present? So, to give it, yeah. So let's say that let's just pick the question right from the book so that I can match the answer. So some tricks in differential equations. Okay, so don't think that I'm doing some higher order differential equations. I don't know any. I'm extremely bad at differential equations, can't imagine. But there is this question, it's not, it looks, but let's see. So first, I'm writing it like this. See if you understand the notation. Okay, and just solve. Just saying solve. So first question, do you guys understand the notation? Okay. So let's see how you solve this question. Yes, yeah, and y is considered as implicitly assumed as a function of x. Okay, so that is just there. Yeah, so just think, there's another interesting type of question. Okay. D of y dash. Okay, so you're a pro. Okay, I don't know how this is true. D of y dashed by x. So you got, is this correct? I've written. Is it what you want to say? So you're using some right. I get it. So then you use some quotient formula, right? You're putting it like this, and you're viewing it as the derivative of something, right? Yeah, that's the golden rule. Yeah, that's right. That's good. So let me give you a more difficult question then. Let's see if you can. So then Rasulu, do you see what is said? I suppose then you guys know all this technology. This is basic from J Advanced. This is very popular. But let's see if you can do this one. It's also simple. So this is a y double prime. And you see this. Okay, let's see this, how this works. I don't know how to do this. I know that there is some trick, but I don't know completely. What d of okay dy dx okay of how do you do this so quickly okay so it's because you're okay now I see no but there's a two okay that's okay so these questions are like that okay so author also did not see these tricks because he has told another way okay I see that so this is very good technique already yeah that I've learned I guess I knew I mean, that, yeah I remember it in my I used to do this but yeah now I forgot it slipped my mind but the way the author suggests is another so simple but yeah says that you can consider this to be the new maybe t okay and then yeah so so basically converting it to a first order so if you do that then how would the equation look like so then if you do dy prime by dx this is y double prime then this becomes dt dx you see so then this becomes x square I mean this thing then becomes x square I mean it's not useful now because you guys have already told the thing but what I wanted to say is just this that this is like this okay nothing I've not done anything just converting it to a first I guess this technique can have more advantage I hope you guys can relate to that right this can but it's nothing it's just converting it to first order let's do another question maybe that's a little more so I don't know so yeah let's do this one so there is x double derivative equal to first derivative equal to no cube of this so if you can again convert it to something it's good that's d dx of equals to y dash or dy by dx same thing whatever yeah that's better this is correct okay so is this correct it's probably correct but let me check it which one so this one will go down no but is x y double dash so what do you do so x y double dash okay yeah simple that's right Okay, so then you guys are pro at this. I don't know. Then it's, I should have not done this maybe. Yeah, then you can do anything. Yeah, seems like. Let me give one more try because again, I don't see a quick solution to this next one. It's not next, actually earlier. Yes, k is some constant. The first derivative is missing in this. I mean, you are welcome to also guess the answer. Now that's actually what I wanted to talk about, because guessing the answer has a big deal, is a big deal exam wise, and also, you know, even rigorously speaking, in this theory. Yeah, that is useless. Can you guess another answer? And what should be the A? Right, A should be K. So, okay, so you have guessed one answer. Can we Can we guess another answer? Why not sine x? That should also work. Yeah, that works, right? So you're saying that any combination of, so once you guess two solutions, you can say that any combination of, but why are these all the solutions? Because if the question is find all solutions, okay, and why are these all, or are these, or why are these all solutions? So that's one thing that you can think about. And the second thing is you can avoid this guessing business and directly solve this. By convert, because I mean, our syllabus is first degree only, right? I mean, usually they will never ask you to solve something which is completely second degree, unless if they put some auxiliary steps or there is something, but whatever. Or solve directly. This is not truly a second degree equation in some sense. I mean, rather it can be converted into first degree because you can see the y prime is missing. And the x is also missing. So try to make some substitution. That's the hint. That's what I was trying to do, but you guys were able to do it without that. So then it's fine. But now maybe we can add this to be just substitution. So either you think of some substitution or you think why these are all solutions. Okay. So maybe do this for homework. Okay. Today I'm stopping a little early. Okay. Just think, these are the two things you have to think about. Okay. So please think about this. Is it fine? Okay. All right. Okay. So yeah, these are the two things. And maybe I'll give you one more question, which is also, you can guess and whatnot. So I was actually stumbled upon it that day. So yeah, maybe, yeah, maybe I'll just write it here. So, and I'll just give some, that is, this doesn't matter. Find all solutions. Here also, you will, you know, have to think a little bit. You can guess and do, but then you have to think a little bit. These are not just tricks now. You have to think a little bit, okay? Because you can, I'm sure you guys can guess now. This is, you're expert at guessing. It's fine. You can guess it, I think. But you have to see, okay? So these are the three things. So please do them. Tomorrow I'll confirm, but I'll take a class. I try to take a class, and yeah, it will be same time, and I'll do integration. I have some other integration problems left from last time. One, I think we'll do that. One probability problem was left. We can, but yeah, improper integral questions we'll do. And I was making one more mock, so I made six problems. So I tried to make some unique things. So it takes a lot of time. But yeah, you guys are already writing, it's good, but purpose of my mock may be slightly different, slightly unique questions will be there. So yeah, six questions I've made, maybe two more I'll see, and maybe I just copy two from somewhere. Okay. Okay, then that's it. Thank you.